Welcome, welcome to the podcast, Awakening to the Voice of Gaia. I'm Catherine Alexander, and I'm so happy to have you here. I'm going to take you on an amazing journey where you will learn how to come home and how to become a partner to life. Healing the centuries-old wound of separation is not an easy thing, but it can be achieved in seconds. First comes understanding, and then the breaking of old habit patterns. Understanding is an inside job. Breaking patterns takes community. I'll be sharing my story and the resources that got me here, and you are welcome to come back and visit at any time. If you want to go deeper, then joining the Third Way community as you learn to live regeneratively would be a good thing. The shift is as easy as shifting from living on the planet to living with the planet. Easy to say and much harder to do. Life loves life, so there is nothing to fear, just old patterns to change. So join me as we explore the wonderful, amazing biology of life and how that changes everything. So here we go. Today we're talking about the body biome. What does that mean? Well, in the beginning, at the very start, there were single-celled organisms that came into being. And that's a whole other story that happened. But once they were here, they got to know each other. And then one cell became two. And then they got so good at relationship and understanding themselves and their needs and all of the other various critters that they were meeting, that they went from one cell to many. So through autopoiesis, through self-making, through their own choice, they became familiar with what they needed. And then they really became familiar with other living organisms and what they needed. And the two of them decided to join. And then the three and four and five and so on. And we got multi-celled organisms. Now, I don't know about you, but when I thought about multi-celled organisms, I was thinking of what happens with babies, you know, that we have one cell, it divides and it gets to be really big until it's a hollow ball. And then all of a sudden things change. So it was more about cells replicating. I don't know that I've ever really understood that it was different species of cells deciding to partner, to live together in symbiosis. When we think of symbiosis, and I'm going to talk about it later, we often think about partnering with other critters. That's one thing. But actually becoming one with something, quite literally, is another. And I think these graphics are a really good description because they're all one, but they're not. They're also all independent. And that is what our body is like. We think of symbiosis as this. Two very different organisms that have decided to partner for mutual benefit. And that's true. There's nothing wrong with that. And it requires a great deal of openness and trust to do that. But when you think of becoming one, two different organisms, or three or four different organisms, deciding to live within one of them as separate entities still, but living in a way that totally supports all of the involved creatures. That's very profound for me. It requires an incredible amount of openness, an incredible amount of trust, both in oneself and in the other. I have to believe that those were agreements that those individual cells made with each other as they discovered how they could work together and how one would serve the other, and then the other in turn serves that one. That's truly the description of right relationship. Now, I think it's important that we really recognize that, because that is what our bodies are. We have made those agreements, and by and large, we keep those agreements. I'm going to talk about that too. But even at the level of the clownfish, the trust, and the agreement is still there. That anemone does not kill that fish. It will kill other fishes, but it will not kill that one. It's able to differentiate. Those two are in a right relationship. And it provides a better world for both. We are over 10,000 individual species. And Dr. Zach Bush, I think, has said 30,000, but I couldn't find it, so I'm going to stick to the 10,000. And there are 700 in our mouths alone. Human beings, who human beings are, that could be kind of a squeamish thing to think about. We want to be pure. We don't want anything else in there. We want to kill all that other stuff. The truth is, we can't. We made those agreements, and we made them for good reason, because we cannot live without them, quite literally. And that is true of our planet. All the living cells, individual life forms on this planet have made that agreement with the whole as well, with life herself, with Gaia herself, and have promised to keep life going forward. That's the prime directive, that all actions create the conditions that support life. Everybody's agreed, except us. We're reneging on that agreement. We're really busy doing things that do not support life. And we're actively killing things. If we don't want it around, we kill it. We don't figure out a way to live peacefully. We don't talk to it. We don't engage with it in any way. We just kill it because we can. That is truly an expression of the power over and the belief in separation that has driven us so much in the past thousands of years, frankly. And it's something that has to change if we're going to stay. Their life makes our life possible. We have no choice. We must become better partners. We must go back into right relationship. Biology of Belief by Sheldon Rupert, The Biology of Belief by Bruce Lipton. Some of you may be familiar with it. I'll put links in the network when I post this. The research he's done talks about how the mind and the body work. The body is full of chemicals, but not all the same chemicals at the same time. There are certain things that trigger chemical releases. And one of the things that triggers chemical releases is our attitudes, another is our emotions, our beliefs, and our words are all things that trigger chemical releases in our body. Now remember, our body is composed of tens of thousands of other individual species who have quadrillions of cells of themselves inside of us. So we're a colony, a biome, a group of things that live together well. Yet we have a profound impact on our very own biome with our attitudes, emotions, beliefs, and words. Words are wonderful because they're so easy to control. In some of the coaching I do, when I use CIQ, communication intelligence, this is the work of a wonderful lady, Judith Bryles. And in the research she did, you can feel, and this is the thing, you can feel. You don't have to believe me. Just pay attention to your own body. The language we use, the tone of voice we have, creates a chemical cascade in our body. When somebody goes, George, there's something that happens inside your body. You're prepared for a confrontation of some sort. There's a little bit of cortisol that gets released. And cortisol does some interesting things. It actually prevents you from thinking. You're not supposed to think when it's fight or flight. Thinking is not an option. It's not needed. So you can't think, you can't remember, you can't learn. So consider how often in your work life in particular, or in your relationship life, maybe you feel yourself in a cortisol bath. So that puts everybody else inside also in a fight or flight mechanism. So they're also not really engaged. They're not sharing their wisdom with you. Everybody's shut down, trying to figure out how to get out of this thing. On the other hand, if you hear, George, there's a sweetness there that opens your heart and makes you warm all over. That's a whole other bath you've just given to all of the cells inside. The sense of caring and being loved. Words can do that. So think, listen to your self-talk. What are you constantly telling yourself? Are you telling yourself how much you're loved? Are the people around you telling you how much you're loved? Are you listening to them if that is what they're telling you? Because they may be, but you may be dismissing it instead. So pay attention to what you say inside. What's that self-talk? Oh, you stupid idiot. Or, oh my God, I was so amazing. What are you saying to yourself? What are you bathing all of those individuals inside with? And this is so important because you can trust your body. You must trust your body. Your body cannot lie. It is not possible for your body to lie. And the only thing your body wants is life, the joy, the satisfaction, the bliss that comes from living. So when you're bathing your body in all these things, is that what you're telling it? Wow, it's so great to be alive. Or, oh shit, I did it again. What are you telling yourself? What is that expression? What are you expressing? And I'm bringing this up because we're entering a time, a liminal time, as we all know, where there is going to be very few rules. there's going to be very few times that what worked before is going to work again. We're really going to have to be way more sensitive to what's needed in the moment than we've ever been before. So this is your chance to practice listening to what knows. The ancient wisdom is here. Your body is old. The cells in your body are old. They have been here for millennia. They've been through a heck of a lot. They know how to respond way more than you with your head do. Your heart's a help, but your body, your whole visceral feeling, your emotions, the things that come up for you, those are where truth lies. And this takes practice. You can't do this in a day. How many of you actually can name more than 5 emotions? Our emotions have nuance after nuance after nuance. Most of us don't even experience it, or if we experience it, we don't have a name for it. So this is the time to practice getting familiar with your body. You need to trust your body. You need to learn how to do that. Now, in a crisis, you will, because things happen too fast to think, and your body can just take over and save you, and that's happened lots of times. When you're in an accident, you don't even remember what you did, but you know that you managed your way through it somehow because your body took over. So this is where you need to be. And along with your body, you've got to trust yourself. And that's the part of you that knows you're you. We are really good at self-deception. Oh my goodness, we have that one so down. And now we've got to peel that away. This is not a time to deceive yourself, to play with yourself, to be fearful with yourself. You have to learn to trust. And that means you have to learn to love yourself enough to trust. This, I truly believe, is the lesson of our age. I had a conversation today with someone about cancer. I had cancer. I had liver cancer. I did not do chemo. I did not do radiation. This was in 2005. I had the tumor out in 2006. I take no drugs at all, and I'm 80 years old. Okay, something worked. And it's because I trusted. I did novel things. I did what I knew I should do for me. Not what anybody else did. Now, other people have done it, yes. And also other people have refused to do the very same things I did. Everyone is different. There are many paths to the same result. But you have to know what's right for you, and your body and your self-trust are the only things that are going to get you there. Your body is a teacher. So practice listening, practice trusting, and gain the confidence that you can trust yourself. That is so important right now. And this is something only you can do. Nobody can tell you how to do it. You have to be courageous enough to test yourself. That's what rock climbing is all about. People who do rock climbing have to trust their body, have to trust themselves. Every decision they make is life-threatening, literally. So you have to know how to move. You have to know what to do. Firefighters, the same thing. These people are so awake because they have to be aware. They have to trust themselves. They have to trust their bodies. People who work on high-rises, I don't know if they still do it. It used to be actually very much a Navajo thing because they were the only ones willing to walk on those braces that they put out to make the building, beams. They would walk on beams, but they also wouldn't walk if they didn't feel like it. They really had to, they trusted themselves. So if they were upset about something or nervous or not present for any reason, they wouldn't work. You have to trust yourself. This is one of the big lessons of our age. the body's responses you can trust. And when you feel joy, that's all of you feeling joy. Realize that. That's why the body is so incredibly wonderful. It is this old wisdom going, yes. It recognizes what's right for it. It's had lots of practice. You, not so much. So learn to listen to those feelings. Joy, excitement, whatever it is. Listen, pay attention, and try to move toward joy, toward excitement, toward gratitude, toward appreciation. That's why gratitude and appreciation are so important. When you bathe yourself in that, you are telling yourself you're loved. You're telling all those folks in there they're loved and appreciated. Everyone loves that. That's something you can do every day. Spend time in gratitude for yourself, in gratitude to them for what they've given you, for the life they've made possible for you. I've been talking a lot about trust, and it's the key to the world because the entire world functions on trust. It's only trust that makes the world work. Trust is life affirming because that's what life wants, is more of life. And that is trustable. So everything in you that urges life, that wants life, that seeks life is trustworthy. It's all those other things that are not. Now we trust in our everyday life without thinking about it. We trust that other drivers are going to pay attention to those painted lines on the road, for heaven's sakes. That's our agreement. Our agreement is you stay there and I'll stay here. And it works. And when somebody breaks that agreement, it's always a catastrophe. Preparing food, buying food, you trust when you go to the grocery store that that food is safe to eat. We trust that. We expect that from others. And it's not a good thing when that trust is broken. When you take drugs, you trust that they're going to do what the doctors say they're going to do. So we put our life on the line in many ways through trust on a continuous basis. But there is a huge difference between trust and blind faith. And here's the test. When you're in relationship, when there's an other you can talk to, and trust is the issue, if you can ask questions that allow you to feel peace and confidence in the situation and in the individual, that's trust. If you're afraid to ask those questions, that's blind faith. That's the, oh, it's all going to be okay. Everything will be just fine. That's not what I'm talking about. You have to be able to ask questions. You have to be able to get answers. If neither one is true, then you're in a blind faith situation, and that is terribly dangerous. Trust is key. Trust is earned both ways, by asking questions and by giving answers, through experience and through generosity. But blind trust is neither of those. We extend trust in a generous way always in the initial encounter with someone else. But then it needs to be tested over time. And having bad things happen does not necessarily mean that trust has been broken. It's what happens after bad things happen. Then you'll know whether trust has been broken or not. The bad things themselves could be very good in the end. So you just never know. Trust is old wisdom. This picture, isn't it lovely? That's your cell, folks. That's a human cell. And that little red ball that you can see is a mitochondria. And the mitochondria are one of the most ancient of individuals. We thought for a long time they were just part of the stuff in the cell, you know, part of the cell's organs, so to speak. But that's not true. Most of those things in there are individual life forms. Cells busy doing their life, making themselves happy as best they can. And in so doing, giving us life. And the mitochondria in particular gives us life. That's where the power comes from. Their skill is in taking the sunlight that comes through chlorophyll and through other things and making it available to other cells like us to power us. And Roundup kills the ATP that mitochondria make. That fatigue that comes from cancer comes because cells are losing the sugars that they normally have because the cancer is taking it. When the cell is healthy and has all the kinds of sugar that it needs, then cancer can't do that. And I speak from experience on that. I could tell the difference when I fortified my cells. I felt stronger. I had more energy. We need to take care of our body. We need to give our body what our body needs. We don't. We feed our mouth and we feed our stomach and we feed our eyes, but we don't feed our body that much. We're seduced by being lazy, by being nice, by blind trust. And it's time to give all that up. I think that's why this time is so scary. It's really calling us to be real. It's calling us to be real. We can't pretend and we can't play games. And we can't deny and we can't procrastinate. We've got to be present and do what we know we need to do, whatever that is. And people can't tell you what that is. But, aha, there's the trickster. I love this understanding that I just got from Pat McKay, Woman Stands Shining, because she really clarified for me something that was fuzzy, has been fuzzy for years. And it's the trickster. So what the trickster is doing is telling us that we're separate, that we're not good enough, that we're stupid, that we should deny what we want. Other people need it more. And that loyalty is the way to go. Be loyal to the trickster. He knows. Balderdash. He has no idea at all. That's the whole point. It's all about you and your trust and your self-trust and your courage to be who you are. That's the way out of this. The trickster cannot take you there. But we have lots of people who have fallen for his game. So this is a time to truly become who you are, to truly learn to trust yourself and trust what your body tells you. When the trickster steps up and says, nah, that's not the way to go. Listen to me. I know. You'll feel it in your body. It won't feel good. It doesn't feel good. And you can push it away. You can insist that it's okay. But I've seen people get sick that way. not to mention the anxiety and all of those things that come along when your body's not happy with all the choices that your mind has made. So trust life, trust joy, and trust your body. Your body knows. So here's some homework. Live for a day doing only what your body says yes to. So only eat foods that your body says yes to. Now watch this one. This is a great practice place because you won't really know, if you're new at this game, you won't really know what your body wants till after you've eaten it. And it goes, yeah, that's not what your body wanted. You got tricked. So practice. You'll feel really good when you hit the right things. You'll know it. And with practice, you'll know it faster and faster. So you won't make so many mistakes. So do it for a day. Just pay attention very much to what your body wants. Where does your body want to sit in the room? Don't just sit. Where does your body want to be? Put a chair there. Who do you really want to talk to? What kind of work really feels good to do today? And then at the end of the day, reflect. What did you learn? What did you notice? Then do it again. So join us. Join the Coming Home Project. You can sign up. Just go there, answer a few questions, and you'll be able to get in and be a member. And then you can listen to these podcasts. You can join others who have listened to these podcasts. You can get the resources that we talk about in the podcast. And you will begin to find other people doing the very same things that you're doing. And we'll figure out together what works. It's a way of testing and sharing and being in an open and safe space where you can begin to practice being truly who you are. I also have a deck of cards, which are available there. It's on Deckable, so you can get it anytime. That show and help you remember the ways in which nature makes it possible for life to thrive. We need to learn what she wants, listen to her, and begin to discern when we can trust, when we're life enhancing, when we're working with, and learn to hear and see the incredible pain that we're enduring when we separate ourselves from things. It's in our everyday language all the time. Learning to discern that separation is key to move from living on the earth to living with it. That is the path forward. We will make that path as we walk. There is no way to see it beforehand. So thanks for listening. I so appreciate your joining me on this journey. To go deeper, check out the Third Way community. The link is on the podcast page and on my own webpage, and you can see it right here. My own webpage is bridgetopartnership.com. You can support my work through donations on my podcast webpage or by joining my Patreon page. I am open to questions and messages, so please connect and be sure to leave your name so that I can reference you when I respond.
It's the new mother nature taking over. It's the new splendor lady come to call. It's the new mother nature taking over. She's getting us all. She's getting us all.